appena Zinat quando c'è ancora sedie, ma non so dove te le puoi mettere. Zinat chiede ancora sedie, anche se non so dove te le puoi mettere. Bon, veni a vedere.
So I think we can start. So good afternoon, everybody. So it's a great pleasure to have Liliana Arrachea here for our CMSP colloquium. Just a very brief bio sketch of Liliana. She got her PhD in University of La Plata in Argentina. After that, she moved for postdocs, including a period as a postdoc here at CISA in Trieste. Now Liliana is professor at the University of San Martin in Buenos Aires, and she has been appointed as a von Humboldt professor in Freie Universität in Berlin, and she worked also at Max Planck. Liliana's work is in various areas of condensed matter, strongly correlated system, quantum transport, and today she will talk about a topic in heat to work conversion in a quantum regime. So please, thank you.
Hello. Yeah, thank you very much, Saro, and thank you for the introduction and also for the invitation. I really feel honored by this invitation. Although I have to say that I'm not used to speak while being organizer of an activity. This is one of the few exceptions. But for this reason, I'm... can someone... Control. Here it goes. Yeah, for this reason, you will see that as there are several participants from our activity here, that I will make at several points of the talk a sort of overview and summary of those topics of our school and workshop, which are related to the main topic of the talk, which is heat to work conversion in the quantum regime. So, yeah, as I said before, the context of this talk is in the middle of this activity, where we are having a series of lectures and talks on all these topics, which are very active topics nowadays. These are all listed. They are quantum heat transport, quantum dissipation, quantum thermodynamics, quantum thermal machines, quantum thermoelectrics, quantum fluctuations, Maxwell demons, and Floquet engineering. And here are all the communities, at least I can identify four big communities, which are thinking and having ideas on this, all these topics. In several of them, are closely related to the main topic of the colloquium. So let me mention a few examples, and then I'm going to go deeply to other cases which are closer to my area of research. The first thing that comes into our mind when we talk about heat-to-work conversion are these thermodynamical cycles that we all studied in textbooks in the school and also in the general physics, in which we have some thermal machine operating, also doing some mechanical work, and typically we have these two regimes where we invest work in order to extract heat from a cold reservoir and to inject it into the hot reservoir, or the other way around, to use the heat flowing from the hot to the cold reservoir in order to generate the work. And we can do it very slowly following these cycles. This is one of the famous cycles. But it turns out that these kind of problems are nowadays formulated in other very different systems. So here we see that we talk about these reservoirs. These reservoirs are macroscopic systems, but not only the reservoirs, also the pistons, also the central pieces of the machine are also microscopic systems. But it turns out that nowadays, people is doing mainly the experimentalists that are doing fantastic things with the different fields, manage to do this kind of cycles with a single ion, for instance. So this is a slide from the lecture of Ferdinand Schmidt-Kahler from our school, and where he explained all the details to how to trap ions, just a single or a few ions, and to operate with optical means in order to produce something very close to this cycle I showed before. And there are plenty of questions in this case. So here, instead of a piston, a macroscopic piston, we have a single ion. And instead of having a macroscopic reservoir, the reservoir, what plays the reservoir here are lasers. And so the devices are completely different, and it's not so easy to translate the concept, the usual concepts of thermodynamics to this context. And actually, in addition to the lectures of Ferdinand, we had very animated discussions precisely today after the talk of Kuritsky related precisely to this type of examples. Another popular example that we know from general physics is this Maxwell demon. This Gedanken beam, this Gedanken beam invented by Maxwell, who is able to operate a small slide, a small window separating two gases in order to move, to collect all the free particles in one side and the hot particles in the other side. And we also had a series of lectures and talks related on how to generate this scenario in small systems. And one example is this one. So this is from the slide of the lecture of Yuka Pekola, which is an experiment where this this mechanism of the Maxwell demon is implemented in a small device, a small electronic device. So this is the typical size, and here electrons are confined and moved by means of applying the voltages. And something very similar to what happens in the case of the Maxwell demon can be implemented here. So there are still also questions on to what an extent, okay, the context is a quantum system. So in the case of the atom, of the ion, we have a single ion, and a single ion is a quantum is a quantum system, but there are also questions on the quantumness of the operational mode itself, and this was addressed, for instance, today by Michele Campisi, where instead using mechanical or classical mechanism to generate the cycle, one can rely on quantum measures, which is something which is purely quantum, quantum mechanical measurement process, in order to also exchange exchange energy, I would say, between two systems in contact to hot and cold reservoirs. So these are the questions that are around. And then I move to another scenario, which is perhaps a clearer context where we have really heat to work conversion, and this is the context of solid state physics of condensed matter, where we have electrical heat to work conversion. As an area, this is a label that receives the name of thermoelectricity. And this is the thermoelectricity as explained in Wikipedia. So thermoelectricity, as explained in Wikipedia, is the possibility, is the effective conversion of a temperature difference into an electrical potential or vice versa. And we can use it in two operational modes. We can use the flow, the heat flow from a hot to a cold reservoir to generate an electrical current in a circuit and in an external circuit. To use an electrical voltage in order to extract heat from a cold reservoir, and in this way we refrigerate. So, formally speaking, it's quite easy to introduce the main ideas behind this. This was treated by Giuliano Benenti last week. We typically have the operational mode of this machine is the following. We have two reservoirs at which we apply a difference of temperature and a difference of chemical potential. And in this way, we have, this is a conductor here, which enables charge flow along with heat flow. And of course, here we have to obey some basic conservation laws. The first conservation law is the conservation of the charge. So all the charge abandoning one reservoir should be injected in the other one. And also conservation of the energy. Given this, and assuming that there is some linear response between the fluxes, so the fluxes, the relevant fluxes here are the heat fluxes and the electrical fluxes, and the forces which generate the fluxes are named in thermodynamics affinities, and these affinities are basically the difference of chemical potential and the difference of temperature. So simply assuming that there is a linear relation between these two quantities, and some basic constraints for these coefficients. So these coefficients L receive the name of Onsager coefficients or transport coefficients. As these are linear, so these coefficients depend on the equilibrium properties of the system. And they, because of that, they obey a micro reversibility, which means that they obey this so-called Onsager relation. So, given these constraints for these coefficients, and given also the constraint that we have to obey the second law of thermodynamics, this means that the net rate of entropy production in this system should be positive. We find some additional constrictions for these coefficients, and from there we can formulate some convenient expressions for the efficiency. The efficiency is as any efficiency, what we want to get divided what we have to invest. In the case of a heat engine, what we want to get is electrical power. It is the numerator, and in the denominator we have what we have to invest. This is the heat flowing from the hot to the cold reservoir. And in the case of a refrigerator, is the other way around. In both cases, this efficiency is bounded by the Carnot efficiency. And using the relations I mentioned in the previous slide, we can very easily show that if we fix the difference of temperature, this efficiency can be parameterized in this way. We have here the Carnot efficiency, and we have here some quantity, which is a combination of the Dyson-Sager coefficients and which receives the name of a figure of merit. So this figure of merit is typically one of the quantities that people use to characterize the quality of the thermoelectrical device. So this is a very nice review by Giuliano and Robert Whitney. Both the three of them participated here. Some of them are around, where they precisely mentioned that in order to get a reasonable efficiency of the device, we need this figure of merit to be at least 3. So as I didn't mention before, that we can notice that the limit, the ideal limit of the Carnot is achieved with this figure of merit goes to infinity. So at least 3 gives some efficiency, which is of the order of 1/3 of Carnot efficiency. So which is the status of the applications? This is a new a recent review on thermoelectricity, and this is the status in the global context. So we see here the power generated by different means. We have here thermoionic and many other types of heat to work conversion. And we have here temperature. We see that the temperature goes up to very large numbers. But and we have here this figure of merit. We can also appreciate that the less efficient process is precisely thermoelectricity. Any other are much better. But still, as it is a nice way to generate, it's a very nice and clean way to generate electricity from waste heat, for instance. There is a strong interest to investigate and to find better and better materials which are more and more efficient. And this is the status of the research. So you see that as time evolves, we have new materials which are pretty close to this ideal, not ideal, but acceptable number 3. This is a nice application, in spite of the fact that it's not very efficient, it is used. It is used because it is a clean mean, it is stable, it is very stable, and it is used precisely in this in the space missions, and this is precisely an example where the heat is produced there is some isotope which is unstable, And in this way, heat is generated, and this generated heat is precisely what is used to. Plutonium. Yeah, I didn't remember the name. Sorry. Thanks. So the question is, what happens if we go to? So these examples are very macroscopic. And let's come back to the subject of our school, what happens when we go to the quantum regime. So what is quantum? So what do I mean by quantum? What I mean by quantum are cases in which the electron propagates coherently. So coherently means that propagates along some distances. Typical distances are some micrometers without experiencing inelastic scattering. So as we know, within the materials, we don't have only the electrons. The electrons have to live with the phonons, and they always scatter with the phonons, and this is the origin of the electrical resistance. But as we go down to very low temperatures, typically temperatures which are much smaller, much lower than the 1 Kelvin. These processes are very slowed down, so the phonons are not so active. And if we work with devices which are actually of the typical size of the domestic devices that we have, for instance, in our computer, we can achieve this regime where the electrons propagate coherently. Importantly, not any device has this nice property of thermoelectricity. In order to have thermoelectricity, we need this important ingredient that is the so-called particle hole symmetry breaking or the energy filtering. This is because if we put one electron reservoir close to and we connect it to another electron reservoir at a lower temperature, if these reservoirs are of free electrons, we have electrons which flow from this left to from the hot to the right to the cold part. But as they are hotter, we also have a counter flow of electrons that try to occupy the empty places left here. And the net effect is that we have two reservoirs at different temperatures, but we don't have a net charge flow. So if we put some filter here, we can somehow avoid some of this counter flow. And in this way, we can get thermoelectricity. So the device must have this important ingredient. Interestingly, in the coherent transport regime, all the information about this energy filtering is encoded in some function here, which has the name of the transmission function. So you see, here I have the relation between the fluxes, the heat and the charge flux, and the affinities. We have here these L's are the transport coefficients. And these transport coefficients in the coherent regime are expressed in this simple way. So this is the derivative of the Fermi function. This is a simple integral. This is the temperature. And all the information of the device is encoded here. So we have to engineer the device in order to have some appropriate transmission function in the coherent regime in order to achieve some good thermoelectric performance. So these are the typical names that are given to the transport coefficients. The diagonal ones are the related to the electrical conductance and the thermal conductance. And the off-diagonal ones, in this, I'm talking about this matrix here, yeah? This L hat is a matrix. So the off-diagonal ones are precisely the ones which produce the thermoelectricity and are receive the name of Peltier and Seebeck coefficients. Some fundamental bounds that these coefficients obey in the coherent transport are the following. The maximum conductance that we can get for a channel, for a given channel, corresponds to this quantum of thermal conductance. This is the electron charge, so this is a fundamental a quantity that depends on a fundamental of fundamental quantities, and the same something similar happens with the thermal conductance, except for the fact that we have here T the temperature, but all the other coefficients in front of the temperature are fundamental constants. In many cases, but not always, it is obeyed this so-called Wiedermann-Franz law. And importantly, one of the one can show that in order to achieve a good thermoelectric response or thermoelectric response, we have to somehow also violate this law. So this is usually the case of the quantum dots. The quantum dots were explained how to construct them by the lectures of Lawrence Mollenkamp. They are typically constructed in sandwiches of these semiconducting structures, doped semiconducting structures, which host there in a two-dimensional electron gas. So I'm going to move to this pointer. Yeah. Some two-dimensional electron gas that the experimentalists manage to operate with the gates. So these gates are built with nanolithography. So this is a device that typically has the size of one micron. And with these gates, they can make operations. So they confine in this small part the electrons. Here, this small part behaves like a sort of atom, so with discrete levels, which are operated by these gates and are also the currents generated. So this play the role of the reservoir. So this leads here play the role of the reservoirs I showed in the sketch before. I like better this point. These quantum dot devices are precisely the typical devices that show thermoelectricity. Why? Because they have, as I said before, a set of discrete levels. These discrete levels play very well the role of energy filters, and in this way enable the thermoelectric mechanism. So this is I borrowed this from the talk of Heiner Linke today or yesterday. I don't remember already. Yesterday. And this is another case, another quantum dot, also from this from the talk of Clemens, where in addition of the discrete levels here, they play with the electrons, the effect of the electron-electron interactions, and the effect of the electron-electron interactions is precisely a way to generate the so-called Kondo effect. This is a strongly correlated state which violates the Biedermann-Franz law I mentioned before. So these are some theoretical and experimental references, and I also would like to mention this one by Misha here with the related idea. I think that also the talk by Fabio Tadei is related to these ideas. But there are other systems which are also very interesting, which are not quantum dots or which contain quantum dots, but they are slightly different, and these are the edge states of topological insulators. And these are states which are paradigmatic regarding the quantum coherence. So the first example of the topological insulator is the quantum Hall effect, which was discovered by von Klitzing, and several Nobel Prizes were related precisely to the fascinating physical features of this phenomenon. It is a state that we obtain when we place the same quantum dot I showed that Mollekamp, for instance, fabricated in a strong magnetic field. In the presence of a strong magnetic field, we know that even in the usual non-quantum case, we have some cross voltage here, the so-called Hall voltage. But the peculiarity of the quantum regime, and this is an effect that takes place at very low temperatures, typically 300 millikelvin or lower, is that for the Hall resistance, so the Hall resistance is associated to the Hall voltage, the Hall resistance, instead of following this straight line, presents these steps. And these steps are very precise at some specific positions that are identified with integer numbers or some special fractions. The integer are the ones named the integer quantum Hall effect, and the fraction are correspond to the fractional quantum Hall effect. So these steps are so precise at some numbers, precise numbers of this unit, that this is used in metrology to define the unit of the electrical resistance. This can be understood. The understanding of this phenomenon is a quite easy for the integer case. It's a quite easy quantum mechanical problem. We just have to solve the Hamiltonian of a two-dimensional electron gas in the presence of a strong magnetic field. And we will find that the structure of levels for this system has this Landau level structure. But as the system has boundaries and as this is a topological state, this system has also edge states, and these edge states are very peculiar and very nice. So the electrons in these edge states propagate chirally, and because of that they are strongly robust and protected, because there is no way to find some impurity and to backscatter and to move in the other direction. And the fractional quantum Hall is a much more complicated problem, because here also play the role the many-body interactions, so the electron-electron interactions in addition to the strong magnetic field. And the result is a quite complicated but also very interesting state. That is precisely in the case of these fractions that received the name of Laughlin state. This was solved and understood by Laughlin mainly, and he got the Nobel Prize because of that. And this state also has edge states, but here, as a result of the strong electron-electron interactions, the electrons live in a collective state. So they don't behave, they behave like a collective quasi-particles, which don't obey a fermionic, neither a fermionic nor a bosonic statistics. They obey a so-called anionic statistics. Because of that, this state is also very interesting in relation to the possibility of implementing topological quantum computing. And it also has a host edge states in which the propagation is chiral, but the quantities that propagate, so the description here is a chiral propagation of bosons rather than fermions. And okay, we had very nice talk by Christian Gladly, who is an expert on the quantum Hall. He's an experimentalist. And he showed that with these edge states, and producing here, constructing here constrictions, it is possible to mimic, to construct systems which mimic optical interferometers. So they are really very interesting systems. And he showed some recent results precisely verifying the fact that in this integer, in this fractional fillings, the quasi-particles behave as if having some fractional charge. So this one-third, for instance, on 2 or 2.5. So electrical transport in quantum Hall has been studied for a long, for some years now since it was discovered. There are still plenty of interesting things to unveil. But thermal transport is rather new. So to measure thermal transport in these small devices is quite challenging. Nevertheless, in the recent time, some time ago, started to appear some experiments in this direction. This is one, I would say, the first example where it was shown that not only the electrons, not only the charge, but also the heat propagates chirally here. And in this is a very nice experiment where it was proved that in one of these constrictions of the quantum Hall, of the integer quantum Hall effect, it is possible to measure exactly this quantum of thermal conductance I mentioned at the beginning. And this was recently also repeated in the fractional case. This is another experiment devoted to study in some other fractional case, heat transport. So far, only heat, no thermoelectricity. But actually, so far, no experiments at all on thermoelectricity in the quantum Hall, but there are several theoretical proposals that are listed here. These are more or less recent papers. Several of them in the integer, but some of them in the fractional as well. So let me very briefly tell you our work, which was published last year, where we show that the charge fractionalization can be used to improve the thermoelectric performance, precisely by recourse of this, thanks to this, the violation of the Biedermann-Franz law I mentioned before. So this is the device. So this is a Gedanken experiment. This is the device that we consider. We have two fractions, fractional states here, and are connected by recourse to constrictions through quantum point contacts through a quantum dot. So we have this quantum dot which makes plays a role of a filter. So this can also be constructed in these quantum Hall structures. And the idea here is that we have these electrons living in these collective states on this side, also in this side. But when they jump to the quantum dot, they have to convert from these collective states to a true electron. And this is the process, this conversion is precisely the process that helps to break this Biedermann-Franz law and can be used for thermoelectricity. This is just to show you that we solve equations. I'm not going to explain you how we solve them, but we write Hamiltonians for each of these parts. And we solve them with a Kellish non-equilibrium Green's function techniques. I'm not going to provide any details about that. I just tell you the result. So this is, as I said before, the process that generates thermoelectricity is the breaking of the Biedermann-Franz law, and like the picture I show at the beginning that holds for single electron systems, where you have this filter and you have these electrons that leave some holes simply. In this case, when some of these some electron jumps into the quantum dot, has to collect all the fractional quasi-particles that are associated to it. And in doing so, it generates a sort of tsunami at the level of the energy. And in this way, the Biedermann-Franz law is broken, and this can be used for thermoelectricity. And the nice thing is that we can show, and these are just some plots, this is the Seebeck coefficient, that this fractionalization helps to enhance thermoelectricity. And this is the result for the integer, and these are the results for the fractional. And we see that this Seebeck coefficient increases, and so is the case of the figure of merit. So these are some estimates taking into account only this process. There is also room to investigate thermoelectricity in a quantum spin hole, so in other topological insulators, and an example is this quantum spin hole nanostructures. They were, this is the first paper in which this material was shown that it to be in the topological state with the peculiarity of hosting now edge states which are not only chiral, but they now also have a spin. So, and it is interesting because one of the edge states are electrons which propagate in one direction with the given spin orientation, and the other in the other direction with the opposite spin orientation. And this was also the subject of some talks here in our activity. Again, there are some theoretical proposals to generate thermoelectricity in these setups in different configurations with the constrictions that generate interference to have some cross effects, applying here difference of temperature and here different difference of potentials to consider nonlinear effects. So there are plenty of things, and they are also quite creative, because you can also play with the role of spin, where you have you can put in addition, considering in addition not only an energy filter, also some magnetic field. It is possible to filter the spin and to, for instance, cool one side rather than more than the other, and so on. There is room to very creative devices and operational modes. But I would like to tell you very briefly this setup, which is really very simple, and it is the following. We have the edge states here in contact to magnets, and we applied at these parts the difference of chemical potential, the difference of temperature, and this is the Hamiltonian. So for those who are from high energy physics can read here the one dimensional Dirac Hamiltonian with the mass term. And this was also mentioned in our school. There is this already old proposal where it was shown that the optimal thermoelectricity, which would correspond to this infinite figure of merit, could be achieved when the transmission function has exactly the behavior of a delta function or something closer to it. So if it's closer, it's close to Carnot, but it doesn't achieve Carnot. And there is also this paper, these papers by Rob Whitney here somewhere, where he showed that in order to get a maximum power, maximum electrical power from these devices, you need some transmission function which has this shape, yeah, the shape of a delta of a Heaviside step function, and this is the bound for the maximum power you can extract for a given channel, and you achieve this when you get this form for the transmission function. And this is the transmission function that we get in this simple setup. So we see that we have here, because the mass terms or the coupling to the magnetic moments opens a gap in the spectrum, we have here something which has an envelope, a Heaviside function, of course, in addition to other oscillations. But it's important that the envelope is this Heaviside function. And because of that, we get, as a result, some power which is very close to the optimal bound which can be achieved. And Daniel is presented already a poster. Almost, I think, more interesting is the following, that if instead of considering just one magnetic moment, we consider two magnetic moments with different orientations, like this configuration, we have a realization of the so-called Chaky-Reby model, in which corresponds to a Dirac Hamiltonian, which a mass having a change of a sign in space. As we move, we have some mass term which changes sign here in the magnetic domain. And the model is known to have a zero mode, which is a topological, which has also a topological origin. So we have here edge states of a topological insulator, but this device as a whole also hosts some zero mode, which is topological in origin. And this is a very, this zero mode is strongly localized, and because of that, produces this delta function like peak, which of course is not exactly a delta function because the magnetic moment has some finite length. and it has some finite width, and this is very good to get a very high figure of merit. So this is the results. In 2 minutes, I just mentioned the possibility of introducing dynamical effects. So the first slide I saw was a Stirling machine where we had, in addition, this time-dependent, this periodic device to play with the work. And now, so this is the way to generalize the thermoelectric treatment in linear response in order to include this dynamical effect is by means of doing some linear response adiabatic expansion, which this is our work, but it's very close to, I mean, it's basically a generalization of what Juan explained in the lectures, and there are other ways of looking at it, for instance, by Anatoly Polkovnikov and also Janine in her talks. Also, there is some work by Michele Campisi and Peter Henge. And I show you the sketch of the formalism in a while. But the idea here is that we have reservoirs where you can put difference of chemical potential, difference of temperatures, but in addition, you have the possibility of exchange work with the agent which makes this cyclic perturbation. And the way is precisely this, to consider the evolution operator in quantum mechanics treated in this way as a frozen contribution plus some correction. This is what we call the adiabatic correction, which is proportional to the rate of change of the time-dependent parameters of the Hamiltonian. So the name adiabatic is because we are assuming, that the rate of change is very slow. Yeah, this velocity is very slow, and because of that, we do a linear expansion in this velocity. Well, we are using the right now just to mention this framework to analyze this. Thermal machines from a geometric perspective. This is a work which was presented in posters by Vivek and Pablo, who are around. And it is quite interesting because we can introduce the geometrical concept, so this adiabatic adiabatic movement can be expressed in this geometrical paths in the parameter space, which allow to a characterization in terms of metrics and curvatures and so on, which is, I think, quite interesting. So this is all I wanted to tell you. Just I would like to acknowledge and thank the collaborations of my PhD students. Daniel and Pablo are around. Lionel is in Buenos Aires. Mariano is an experimentalist, so we are also doing some experimental work in relation to the quantum Hall effect. And we are also collaborating with the PISA group, and the students there are Gian Michele Blasi and Vivek, who is also around, and also ex-students and postdoc, Florencia Ludovico was also around. This in blue are all the experimentalists. There are some in Buenos Aires, and we are also collaborating with the people from colleagues from Max Planck Stuttgart and ETH, and other colleagues from Bariloche, Argentina, Eduardo Franklin, David, who was around, Rosa, who was last week, Misha Moskales from Ukraine, Alessandro, Fabio, around, and Matteo from Pisa, Saro, and Felix von Oppen from Berlin. So thank you very much.
Thank you. So, questions? So I can start with a question. So about the topological zero mode. It's not really important it's topological. Do you really want to have just a bound state at zero energy, right?
I think it's important because if it is topological, you can argue that it's robust against some perturbations, and I think this is what is...
So you want it to be stick at the Fermi energy, at zero energy?
No, you don't. So there if you have other orientations of the magnetic moment, you can move it from the zero energy. Yeah, but yes.
Okay.
So with your suggestion about spin hole device, would nonlinear effects in thermal electricity change it towards you exceed upper bound or other way around? How would it work?
Well, nonlinear may be complicated to treat because so here we are assuming that we are having a very weak contact between the two edge states. But if you move away from the nonlinear, you put a strong difference, voltage difference, for instance, you can move to some other fixed point where your two edges get in touch. So all the behavior can change drastically. So here, I could eventually play with the, and I think that within including non-linearities, but within still small voltage differences, it could eventually improve.
Linear with temperature, not with voltage.
With both, yeah. But any of them, you know, if you increase it a lot, you move to another fixed point, and your edge state start to behave completely differently. Yeah.
So a general question on the field. You showed the enhancements for the thermoelectric effect as the ZT parameter. The question is, are those results all at low cryogenic temperatures, or are there any at the...
No, these are all at low cryogenic
and
temperatures.
Then the question is, how do you feel about the findings? So where the field is going and the possibility of finding this at higher temperatures?
Well, all these effects, so it's impossible to get a quantum hole. So these are basic, this is basic research. I'm not thinking on this for applications. Perhaps the only application that you can think about this is precisely in lab. Imagine in lab that you are, so it's very challenging to go to very low temperatures in lab. So if in your device you have something that thermoelectrically helps to cool, it's something interesting. But of course you don't even have a quantum hole at high temperatures. In order to get the effect, you must go below 1 Kelvin or so. So all this is cryogenic. In addition, when you introduce the effect of temperature, the phonons, as it was said many times during our activity, phonons start to play an important role, and plenty of these nice features are destroyed. Yeah.
Talking about Maxwell Dillon.
state, then you can extract some work. Now, this is in the in
no, no, but it wasn't. It's not the Maxwell demand was mainly.
I mean, if you make a measurement on the, then this allows you to. I mean, like in classical example, like the Szilard engine, etc. So, what happens in the quantum domain? Does quantum in the quantum domain can you violate these classical relations or?
Well, so I'm not the expert in this field. Perhaps some of my colleagues can answer better than me. But I, roughly speaking, I said that all these experiments and all these proposals are basically classical. So the context is quantum because you are in this experiment by Pecola, for instance. So today we had a very long discussion about the quantumness of all these effects, which I think is very interesting. But yeah, it was at the very beginning, sorry. Yeah, here. This experiment for example, is you have a quantum context, but the process itself is quite classical. So the electrons, here you have electrons which are trapped one by one, but they also are moved one by one. So it's at the end of the, you don't have any quantum effects playing a role in the demon mechanism itself, I would say. And we all also had another talk today with the conclusion. So I don't know if there are realizations of this Maxwell demon, which are really quantum.
No more questions, so thanks a lot, Liliana. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much.